Come on, I haven't got time for this. Come on, baby. Come on. Great, great. There. Could you tell me where the nearest gas station is? Sir? Or could you tell me where there's a phone? Now, for Pete's sake, I'm gonna be late. Hey! Look, could you give me a hand? You don't look like you're incredibly busy. There might be some money in it for you. Look, buddy, even my watch is stopped. Could you at least tell me what time it is?
Once upon a time, there lived a man who loved to tell stories. Now that he's dead, there's no stopping him.
Yourselves down and take a load off. I don't have to worry about that. No flesh, no load. You won't get that till you're dead. My name is Skin and Bones, and welcome to my tales of terror. Oh, I'm gonna scare you, I'm gonna make your teeth chatter. And I'm gonna give you some stories to tell your kids. But first, I have some introductions to do. Of course, I, as I say, am Skin and Bones. And you might be wondering right off the bat why I would wear a hat indoors. Well, I'll tell you, if you had a receding skin line, you'd wear a hat too. Anyway, this is my dove. Rex! Rex, where are you? Oh, you're there all the time. He plays his tricks on me. This is my dog, Rex. Say something to the people, Rex. Of course. I don't understand the thing he's saying. So, the business at hand. Scary stories. I am your host for this half hour. Well, let's see. Okay, 27 minutes. You'll be scared, you'll be frightened, and you'll have a lot of fun. So sit back, strap on your diapers, and hold on to your hair. These are my stories. We start off today with a really spooky story. It's called The Girl Who Stood on a Grave. So boys and girls were at a party one night. There was a graveyard down the street, and they were talking about how scary it was.
Don't ever stand on a grave after dark, one of the boys said. The person inside will grab you, and he'll pull you under.
That's not true,
one of the girls said.
That's just a superstition.
I'll give you a dollar if you stand on a grave.
a dollar. Big time spender, yeah.
Grave doesn't scare me,
said the girl.
I'll do it right now, and for only 50 cents.
Oh, she knew her stuff. The boy handed her his knife.
Stick this knife in one of the graves, he said. Then we'll know you were there.
Now the graveyard was filled with shadows. It was as quiet as death.
There's nothing to be scared of,
the girl told herself. But she was scared anyway. She picked out a grave and stood on it. Then quickly she bent over and plunged the knife into the soil. Then she started to leave. But she couldn't get away. Something was holding her back. She tried a second time to leave, but she couldn't move. She was filled with terror.
Something's got me,
she screamed, and she fell to the ground. When she didn't come back, the others went to look for her. They found her body sprawled across the grave. Without realizing it, she had plunged the knife through her skirt and then pinned it to the ground. It was only the knife that held her, and she had died of fright.
Pretty.
You gotta know better when you're out in a graveyard. Well, Rex, did you like that one? Please say you did. You're so finicky. Good boy. We'll continue. This one is called A New Horse. Two farmhands shared a room. One slept at the back of the room, the other slept near the door. After a while, the one who slept near the door began to feel very tired early in the day. His friend asked him what was wrong.
An awful thing happens to me every night, he said. A witch turns me into a horse and rides me all over the countryside.
I'll sleep in your bed tonight, his friend said. We'll see what happens to me.
About midnight, an old woman who lived nearby came into the room. She mumbled some strange words over the farmhand, and he found he couldn't move. Then she slipped the bridle onto him, and he turned into a horse. The next thing he knew, she was riding him across the fields at picnic speed, beating to make him go even faster. Soon they came to a house where a party was going on. There was a lot of music and dancing. They were having a pretty big time inside. She hitched him to a fence and went in. While he was gone, the farmhand managed to rub against the fence until the bridle came off. Then he turned back into a human being. Then he went into the house and found the witch. He spoke those same strange words over her. And with the bridle, he turned her into a horse. Then he rode her to a blacksmith and had her fitted with horseshoes. After that, he rode her back to the farm where she lived.
I have a pretty good filly here,
he told her husband.
But I need a stronger horse. Would you like to trade?
The old man looked her over and said he would do it. So they picked out another horse, and the farmhand rode away. Her husband led the new horse to the barn. He took the bridle off and went to hang it up. But when he turned around, his new horse was gone. What he saw was his wife standing there with horseshoes nailed to her hands and feet. I hate witches. I'd say it's the first night of very. Oh, I got a kick out of that. Oh, real scary. Don't you think? Hallowe'en is such a fun time of year. It makes your heart race with frightful feelings. But there's always the comfort in knowing that you will never really be harmed. Until you watch my show. Oh, well, on to the next story. These ones will be quite traditional in nature. Because it's that time of year, of course. Hallowe'en. Don't you just love it? Adults can dress up as their favorite creatures. Legally, for a change. Well, on with the stories. The White Wolf. The timber wolves around French Creek had gotten out of hand. There were so many wolves, the farmers could not stop them from killing their cattle and sheep. So the state put a bounty on them. It would pay a hunter $10 for every wolf pelt he turned in. The butcher in town, named Bill Williams, thought this was pretty good money. He stopped working as a butcher and started killing wolves. Little difference, if you ask me. So, he started killing wolves, and he was quite good at it. Every year, he killed over 500 of them. That came to more than $5,000. It was quite a bit of money back then. After 4 or 5 years, Bill had killed so many wolves, there were hardly any left. So he decided to retire. And he vowed never to harm another wolf because they had made him so rich. Then one day, a farmer reported that a white wolf had killed two of his sheep. He had shot at him and hit it, but the bullets had no effect. Soon that wolf was seen all over the countryside killing and running, but nobody could stop him. One night he came to Bill's yard and killed his pet cow. Bill forgot about his decision never to harm another wolf. He went into town the next morning and bought a young lamb for bait. He took it into the hills and tied it to a tree. Then he backed off about 50 yards and sat down under another tree with his gun in his lap. He waited. But Bill didn't come back. His friends started looking for him. Finally, they found the lamb. It was still tied to a tree. It was hungry, but it was alive. Then they found Bill. He was still sitting against the other tree, but he was quite dead. His throat had been torn apart. But there was no sign of a struggle. His gun hadn't been fired, and there were no tracks in the soil around him. As for the white wolf, he was never seen again. Oh, I love those revenge stories. They get me right here. Ooh, I'm down a quart. Shall we continue? I think we shall. Aaron Kelly's bones. Aaron Kelly was dead. They bought him a coffin, had a funeral, and buried him. But that night, he got out of his coffin and went home. His family was sitting around the fire when he walked in. He sat down next to his widow, and he said, "What's going on? You all act like somebody died. Who dead?" His widow said, "You are." "I don't feel dead," he said. "I feel fine." "You don't look fine," his widow said.
You look dead. You better go back to the grave where you belong.
I'm not going to the grave until I feel dead, he said.
Since Aaron wouldn't go back, his widow couldn't collect his life insurance. Without that, she couldn't pay for the coffin. And the undertaker said he would take it back. Aaron didn't care. He just sat by the fire, rocking in his chair and warming his hands and feet. But his joints were dry and his back was stiff. And every time he moved, he creaked and cracked. One night, the best jazz man in town came to court the widow. Since Aaron was dead, the jazz man wanted to marry her. The two of them sat on one side of the fire, and Aaron sat on the other side, creaking and cracking.
How long do we have to put up with this dead corpse?
The widow asked.
Something must be done, the fiddler said. This isn't very jolly,
Aaron said.
What's the dance?
The jazz man got his trumpet and began to play. Aaron stretched himself, shook himself, got up, took a step, and began to dance. Well, with his old bones rattling, and his yellow teeth snapping, and his bald head wagging, and his arms flip-flopping, around and around he danced. With his long legs clicking, and his knee bones knocking, he skipped and pranced around the room. How that dead man danced. But pretty soon, a bone worked loose and fell to the floor.
Look at that, man,
said the jazz man.
Play faster,
said the widow. And the jazz man played faster. Crickety-crack, down and back, the dead man went hopping, and his dry bones kept dropping. This way, that way, the bones just kept dropping.
Play, man, play,
cried the widow. The jazz man played, then dead Aaron danced. Then Aaron fell apart, collapsed into a pile of bones. All except his bald head bone, which grinned at the jazz man, cracked its teeth, and kept dancing.
Look at that, man,
said the jazz man.
Play louder,
said the widow.
Ho ho, said the head bone. Ain't we having fun?
The jazz man couldn't stand it.
Widow,
he said,
I'm going home, man.
And he never came back. The family gathered up Aaron's bones and put them back in the coffin. They mixed them up so that he couldn't fit them back together again. After that, Aaron stayed in his grave. But his widow never did marry again. Aaron had seen to that. Oh, I hate when this happens. Oh, I hate that. See what happens if you live a lifestyle where you're just sitting around? Someone will go and make a nest in your chest cavity, for Pete's sake. I have a special treat for you right now. And I hope you enjoy it. It's all about how Hallowe'en started. So sit back, strap on your diapers, and hold on to your hair. These are tales of terror.
Concentrate here. Stop staring at me, will you? And wipe that stupid grin off your face. Well, Jack, I'm sorry to say this, but I call. Pair of lucky sevens. Now, let's see what you got. Three queens? That's too bad. Three queens. Pair of sevens? That's too bad. Come on. It's Hallowe'en night. Where is everybody? I've got candies, kids. I mean, that's what this whole Hallowe'en's all about, right? Candy? And little beggars? Well, fine. Then miss out on the whole purpose of Hallowe'en. Huh? No? Then what's Hallowe'en all about? Huh? I wish somebody could tell me what Hallowe'en's all about. Huh? Whoa. First customer. Well, their loss. It's like I always say. That's an awfully big kid. I'll give him a big prize. They don't want it? That's fine. Treat. I mean, you're supposed to say trick or treat, and I'm supposed to give you candy. Well, that's what you're here for, isn't it? Candy? That's what Hallowe'en's all about, right?
No.
No? Well, what are you here for?
You. So. You want to know about Hallowe'en, do you?
Well, yeah.
I have come to show you.
Hey, where am I?
You're in a montage, idiot. Now shut up. While it has gone through many changes during the last two millennia, Hallowe'en has always been associated with death. The ancient Celtic peoples of England, Ireland, and Scotland celebrated a festival the night before their new year, which started on November 1st. The festival, called Samhain, was the biggest and most significant holiday of the Celtic year. At this Christian time, the Celts believed that the spirits of those people who had died during the year traveled into the other world. The people sacrificed animals, made offerings of fruit to vegetables, and lit bonfires to honor the dead, aid them on their journey, and more importantly, keep them away from the living. For Samhain was a night when all manner of beings were abroad, ghosts, fairies, and demons. Later, when Christian missionaries tried to change the religious practices of the Celtic people, Samhain became the Hallowe'en we are familiar with. As part of their efforts to wipe out pagan holidays such as Samhain, the Christians brought about major transformations. Instead of trying to obliterate people's customs and beliefs, the missionaries were instructed to use them. They branded the earlier deities as evil and associated them with the devil in an effort to diminish beliefs in the traditional gods. The spirits of the dead still traveled, fairies and demons still roamed. But the church tried to define these creatures as not only dangerous, but malicious. But over the years, the old beliefs never really died out, and another approach was deemed necessary. In the 9th century, the Catholic Church tried to replace Samhain by establishing November 2nd as All Saints' Day, or All Hallows' Day. Hallow being simply another word for saint. On this day, the living prayed for the souls of the dead, and they I continued the Celtic tradition. The evening prior to the day was the time of the most activity, both from human and supernatural. All Hallows' Eve was celebrated as a time of the wandering dead. But the supernatural beings were now associated with evil. People attempted to appease these spirits and their masked impersonators by setting out gifts of food called soul cakes. Consequently, All Hallows' Eve, alias Hallowe'en, alias Hallowe'en, is a Celtic New Year's Day in modern dress. Virtually all of our Halloween customs today can be traced to the ancient Celtic Day of the Dead. Pranks have always been associated with Halloween because of the increase in supernatural activity on this night. Gates were removed, fences were broken, and outhouses were overturned in days of old. But more often, these offenses were committed by human pranksters taking advantage of the festivities. Today, car windows are soaked, pumpkins are broken, and eggs are thrown by youngsters eager to carry on the tradition. Imagery abounds on Halloween. Blackcats and witches are only two that conjure up the feelings of mystery about the night. Witches were once believed to possess magical powers that were given to them by the devil, while black cats were thought to be possessed by the souls of sinful people. Some were even believed to be witches who had taken an animal form. Trick-or-treating had its beginnings in the first few centuries of Christianity, when food and drink were left out to appease the souls of the dead who were on their way to the other world. As centuries wore on, people began dressing as these dreadful creatures and performing antics in exchange for offerings of food and drink. The practice, called mumming, has evolved into our present-day trick-or-treating. To this day, witches, ghosts, and skeleton figures are among the favored disguises. There you have it. That's what Halloween's all about. Now can you see that Halloween is more than just candies and treats?
Well, I don't know. You still haven't convinced me. I mean, you said the ancient Celts made offerings of fruits and vegetables, which would have been a treat back then. Having food, period, would have been a treat, I would imagine. Then you said that people centuries later would give soul cakes to ghosts so that they wouldn't bother the townspeople? Cakes?
Yes.
And to top it all off, if candy doesn't have anything to do with Halloween, then how come it's managed to remain part of it for hundreds of years? And is to this day a multi-million dollar industry?
I guess I never really looked at it that way before.
Uh-huh.
Give me one of those.
Oh, no. You gotta say trick-or-treat first. Here you go.
Hey, now that's pretty good.
Boy, if you had lips, I'd swear you were smiling.
Is that a joke?
Well, yeah.
Good one.
Make-believe if you believed in me. Without you, along. It's a honky-tonk parade.
Yes, tune in for more Skin and Bones Tales of Terror. If you dare. Don't watch it alone. Just when you thought it was safe to sit in front of the TV. Oh, that is one.